Right, welcome to the Bear Pit Pod. We're back. We had a break.
Didn't do one last week, did we?
Didn't do one last week.
I don't know why, we just didn't.
Just poor planning.
Yeah, it was.
Just always poor planning.
Yeah, simple as that.
On this pod, well, towards the end, we're going to be giving away... Well, we're not going to give it away on at the end of this pod. We're going to be giving this away, signed by Cider Berahino. There's still going to be more signatures to come.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're not watching... on YouTube and listening to the podcast, it's a Stoke shirt that I'm pointing at.
Yeah, it's not just a Fruit of Loom shirt.
Yeah, exactly. It's a Stoke shirt. You can find us on YouTube, SoundCloud, Acast,
iTunes. And iTunes is that in general, isn't it? But iTunes,
always forget one.
Yeah, like, that's the big one as well. One.
Yeah, iTunes, of course, of course. We will start off with following on Chelsea at the weekend. A performance to be...
It was good.
Yeah, not to be ashamed
of. It was good. We didn't
get rolled over or...
Yeah, I mean, on top of the Man City draw, that's two fixtures on the bounce against arguably the two best teams in the league, certainly the best team in the league, and we finally start rolling over against these better teams. And even though we lost, no one ever wants to lose, obviously, I felt quite reassured that we actually put a bit of performance in. We dug our heels in for once. We didn't just turn up and get rolled over.
Mm.
It was a good performance.
It was
good.
It's
so frustrating we had that winner.
We had chances to win it.
We did.
When it was 1-1, we had a good 10-minute spell where we had about four or five corners in a row.
Corners on the bounce, yeah.
And
Ramadan had the worst shot of all time.
Ramadan had a shot that nearly went out for a throw, and if it wasn't a Stoke player on the other side of the pitch. It was enough to be ashamed of. And then, you know, it was our own mistakes, really, not capitalising, and then some shocking defending.
It was awful, wasn't it? Am I being a bit over the top when I say we played better in the second half? Am I got my Stoke tinted glasses on slightly there?
I don't think so. I think we...
They didn't create much.
I think we had more chances.
Yeah, they hit the bar from a free kick. Other than that, I'm really struggling to think of a decent chance to be creating in the second half. A bit of space down the wings, but I think we... I feel proud in saying that that's probably one of the hardest tests that Chelsea's have had this season, really.
That's one of those where, you know, that's sort of the turning point for them. You know, if you get through a tough away game at Stoke, you've got
cliche.
Every right to be champion.
100%.
And that's, you know, a lot where we see a lot of big teams sometimes come unstuck. Your Arsenals, your Man United, we've done well against.
I thought we played 20 times better against Chelsea than we did Man United as well.
Yeah.
I think Man United were a tad fortunate to get the point, but it's all about 4-4-2, isn't it?
Mm.
All about 4-4.
Seems more.
It's so much more robust.
Mark Hughes just fucking changing formations like it's anything
the
now.
Wind, didn't he?
Three this season.
Yeah, yeah.
For a philosophy and a style and sticking with it.
I don't know whether it was forced upon him, whether the penny dropped, whether the management team, the assistants, and all the rest of it said, "Look, we just need to play this formation." But it just seems to work so seamlessly that you wonder why he's not tried it before.
Yeah.
We look so much more steady and stable and defensively minded with a 4-4-2.
All we were missing is him to come out in his press conference, read that poem. What's the poem?
I don't know which one.
From Mike
National
Bassett.
Poetry Day, by the way.
Mike Bassett.
You'll Be a Man, My Son, that one.
Read that and then walk out saying, Stoke will be playing 4-4-2. That's all we were missing.
Mm.
So,
yeah. The big question is now whether the 4-4-2 is kept exclusively for the tougher teams.
Yeah.
Or whether the second. To be fair, the 4-3-3 at home has worked against the lesser teams, really, hasn't it?
Yeah, they're the only teams we've been beating this season.
Yeah,
so,
I know.
So, yeah.
Whether he'll keep it for, who have we got next?
Leicester away.
Who, annoyingly, a bit of a resurgence themselves. Whether he'll keep 4-4-2, I think he should.
Well, they play 4-4-2.
Yeah.
So that'd be... I wouldn't be so confident there. They're good at 4-4-2.
Yeah.
I don't know we should try and go and play them at their own game.
Or just sit, just two teams sitting. No one wants to attack.
Yeah, you know what? You know, everyone knows exactly what Leicester are about.
Yeah,
balls over the top. Look for Jamie Vardy. They've got good players in Mahrez and Slimani if he plays. They've obviously got a decent. Do you know what? It's weird saying that Leicester have got a decent side because they haven't.
Really?
They were just good last year and won the fucking
and
league.
And they've just started clicking again now. But I don't. Yeah, great performance. Joe Allen, Jeff Cameron seems to work very, very well.
Very interesting one. I was listening to, I shouldn't plug other people's, but I was listening to the Front Three podcast on the way here, and Jeff Cameron had the worst pass completion rate of anyone, 57%.
Yeah. You know what?
The most tackles.
Yeah, because he's losing it half the time, probably. I think since Jeff's come back, I think it's been very evident that his footballing ability has been a bit sloppy. his touch isn't that great, but he is more than making up for that with his kind of work rate and his athleticism. He just seems to get about all over the place, and he's kind of, I'm forgiving his kind of poor touch at the moment, just because he is clearly having an impact on the first 11.
Yeah, and he's only just come back, so there can be excuses. Yeah, he's not probably 100% there.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
But, he's doing well.
Yeah, and I also think it was Joanne's best game in quite a while.
Yeah. Well, I think me and you both said that Joe was on a bit of a downward spiral, not spiral, because he isn't drinking out of brown paper bags and sleeping on the streets. He's not all the way there.
No.
But he just wasn't in the best of form.
I didn't really know where. I mean, Joe Allen obviously has been playing further forward recently, but in the 4-4-2, he was very flat, wasn't it? Midfield. He wasn't really pushing up to support the strikers.
Necessarily pushed on anyone else.
Yeah.
Apart from the wingers, obviously. Yeah. To get forward.
It was good. I'm really happy with
it. Sobby didn't have a great game.
He was all right. I don't think he was poor by any means. I thought he played quite well.
I think from the past few games, I've expected too much from him.
I still think he was really good at it. First half, he was very, very mature on the ball, which I've said about a million times, and I must get boring. But he was clever with it. He wasn't trying to skim people necessarily. Mm. I think he was all right. I never picked him out for having a poor game necessarily. I thought he was good.
Yeah.
So I have noticed recently, I've been on that forum, the Oakgate forum.
Have you?
And I know
even Martin Smith wanders off the Oakgate.
Yeah, he owns a bloody thing. But I can't help myself. I want a bit of some forum chat. So I go on it. But
forum chat, late night forum chat,
late night forum Stoke City chat. And there was a thread about Berahino, and it's not taken long for the miserable Stoke fans to come out and start slightly questioning him. It's only been a few months,
and it's only been three games.
Yeah, a few
two
moons,
games,
but,
three games.
I mean, these fans on the whole are idiots to be questioning now, but a few of them were saying that is he all what he's cracked up to be, because his performance against Chelsea is questioned quite a lot by a few. I don't agree with them at all. I'll get that right in there, but it's just interesting to read these comments.
I think it's going to take some time for him to get back to the level he is, especially as I don't think he's match fit, and if I'm being completely honest, I think he's a little bit pudgier than he should be. But as soon as he does get Mark Hughes has been after this guy for three fucking weeks, seasons, or three transfer windows.
Yeah.
He hasn't done that for no reason. Hopefully.
No. We assume he knows what he's doing, Mark.
I assume he knows what he's doing. I assume Eddie Mann maybe grabs two or three goals by the end of the season.
Hopefully.
And, it's a good platform to build on for next year.
Yeah.
Summer, get him fit.
Yeah.
He starts next season. Yeah. He's out and out striker. Yeah. Hopefully he goes and gets 20 goals like he did for West Brom.
Fingers crossed.
I'm not going to start making any judgments on him so far, and I don't think anyone should.
No.
Idiots on the OK.
Well said.
So I know that you come up from London for games.
Yeah.
I come up from London for games.
Uh-huh.
Do you often go to games by yourself, or are you always with someone?
Home games, I sit with me dad, me two brothers, my uncle. So home games, no, never. Away games, no. The answer is no, basically.
Right,
never.
I don't do it often, but I did this weekend. I went by myself.
Did you?
Yeah, and I don't.
How'd you find it?
It's weird. It's weird going by yourself, isn't it? Because I was giving my girlfriend's dad's season card because he was on holiday.
Yeah.
So I used it as a ticket. Mad enough as well. This is in the booth, and he's got his name on his seat.
Has he? My dad, because I've got a season ticket, as my dad and my brother's. My dad's got his name on it, Mr. Beresford. I've not got my name on it. I don't know why. It's always annoyed me that.
Yeah, it's true.
Yeah.
I don't know why that is.
I don't know.
No,
you assume
idea.
That if your season ticket
is it
seat changes.
So long, or?
Yeah, I think so, but I've not got mine.
Special privileges.
Winds me up a little bit.
But yeah, I went to the game. Went by myself. It's a bit weird. But when I was wandering around at half time in the booth, and a guy called Aid Turner, I think that's his name, came up to me and said, love the pod. He came and said he loved the pod.
Cheers, Aid.
Likes that you can resonate with some Stoke fans. He isn't the only one thinking these strange and dark thoughts about the side.
Yeah.
But just thought I'd give him a shout out because he came up to us. We've got a good chat for pretty much the whole of the half.
So you made a friend as well,
made
which
a friend.
Is nice.
I'm happy
for you. I don't like the thought of you being all lonely at Stoke.
I know.
But it's good.
But it's never really lonely because obviously a lot of people recognise you from Bear Pit and come say hello and stuff. Obviously, like Aid did. But yeah, it was a strange one. I don't go to games on my own that often.
You know what? Weirdly, the one of few occasions where I did go on my own was at Tottenham away recently. Obviously, we got battered 4-0. It was horrendous. I went with me brother Lee and me mate Mark. They left after 30 minutes.
That's
30 minutes. That's so we all went to the concourse.
Spurs.
Spurs, yeah, you went, didn't you? So
I spent half hour in the concourse.
Yeah, well,
half time.
Yeah, we all went down at 30 minutes after the third goal, I think it was, to have a beer. And then they just left and went to the pub. So the whole second half, I was on my own.
Yeah.
Right up against the Spurs fans to my right. I just sat there on my own. And I don't know why I went back. It's weird, isn't it?
Strange.
It's quite a lonely experience. I was having a little chat to a steward, but it wasn't really interesting what I had to say, surprisingly.
Yeah.
I don't know why.
Difficult one.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was, like I say, it was, I think that's the second game I've been by myself.
Would you do it again?
Yeah, made friends.
It's nice to see you. I'm looking for you.
This podcast, the majority of it is us answering questions what people have fired in or asked or wanted us
to
speak about. And I think I should go to this question first from Charlie Best, it seems as though it follows on from the last game and a lot what I think me and you have spoke about, maybe. Erik Pieters.
Yeah.
He can't cross.
Can't
cross a road.
If I have to see another looping cross that drifts over the back post,
usually usually can't beat the first man. There was one against Chelsea.
At least he's getting above it.
Yeah, he went on the other side of the
and
pitch
and stand as well. It's so annoying.
How much longer has Erik Pieters got? Because before this season, sometimes people had questioned him and him going forward.
Yeah,
and people would be like, "What the hell are you on about? He is our most consistent defender." But this season, he's not as consistent.
No, I mean, I'm going to be as fair as I can to Erik Pieters. Defensively, I think
defensively
A-OK,
he's sound,
fine.
But in this day and age, we need
fullbacks
more of
are a big
left
deal,
back.
Aren't they?
Yeah,
and especially we're in the 4-3-3, not so much in a 4-4-2, but a 4-3-3, which we were obviously playing for a while. They were very important, but
when so much is expected of your fullback to be putting balls and to link up with the final third, needs more.
Yeah, to be honest with you, if Muniz was consistently fit, slash if he's fit now, he starts. 100%. There's
I'd
no
like
doubt
to
in my
see
mind
it.
At all.
I think a lot of fans would like to see Muniz given a start. And
I mean, look at the goal he scored against Burnley, the way he created from the start.
He's Beckenbauer-esque.
He was class. I mean, he's clearly a good footballer, but unfortunately for Muniz, I don't think the issue is his ability, it's his fitness.
Yeah, it is.
I mean, even though he's on the bench now, I don't really know the reality of what fitness is like. If Muniz is fit, he starts.
You went for the full Catalan then. Muniz.
That was me just fucking up. But yeah, I'll go with that. I went for it. I went for the accent. If he's fit, he plays. Erik Pieters, I can't bear to see another looping Pieters special from the left.
I don't think many
I see
can.
Him running up to it. You know, he's got acres and you just say, oh, God.
It's like he's got too much time to think about it.
I feel sorry for him a bit because I think he's been a decent Stoke player. But he's getting a lot of stick at the moment. Myself included, because you know what, reverting back here, I just complimented him on his defensive abilities. How can I say that for what happened on Saturday?
Oh yeah, he was at fault for the
second let's just reverse quickly. Not all of his defensive work is great, because what the fuck was he doing?
I've got no idea.
I mean,
I can't even speak about that goal.
It was comical, Sunday League defending, and it hurts more the fact that Chelsea didn't deserve that. We gifted him a goal.
Just give it.
We've done the hard work and we gifted him a goal.
Just give it him.
Yeah.
But yeah, Erik Pieters in the summer for me. New signing or just he can stay.
Someone
to challenge him.
I don't think we can rely on Muniz as much as I'd love to. We just can't. No. So I think a left back should be something we need to look into.
It's something we need to.
Pieters
address.
Is a very, very good squad player. And he's more than a decent cover, but I don't think he should be starting at the moment.
No.
There we go. No. Sorry, Eric.
Sorry, Eric. We've answered that one for you, Charlie. Scotto asked us to do a loan roundup. So I've done this for you, Craig.
Cheers, mate. Yeah.
So obviously, at the minute, we've got Walshire, Josselu, Bojan and Hogard.
Walshire's pulling up trees, I hear.
Yeah, so Walshire was in the lab for the majority of this season. He hasn't even really played. He's been exiled from the squad.
Yeah.
But he was sent to the reserves, which is in like the
C League, is it? League One
or
fifth? Oh, is it that low, is it?
Yeah, it's that low. Right. Fifth tier of German football. But
found his level.
He's recently been recalled back to the first team squad. I think it might be because they've had a new manager.
How good or bad can he be that he can make that sort of jump?
I know. Because I did know that Wolfsburg were after David Wagner from Huddersfield.
Okay.
But he rejected it. So they've had a new manager, it seems, and he's been recalled to the first team squad. He's still not made any appearances, but he's going to be back with us in the summer.
You know my thoughts on Walshire. Before I even started doing the bear piss, I had little chats with you. You know, he's not with Stoke at the moment, but he is I don't rate him at all. I could use stronger words, but I won't slag off a current Stoke player, but he is not for me at all.
You don't like him,
do
not
you? In a million years. There's too many mistakes in him.
There is too many too mistakes. Many mistakes. He's very unorthodox.
Yeah, he's a bit weird.
Wow. He's a bit weird.
I get the impression he's a bit odd. I don't know why. I'm probably making it up in my head, but there's something that just doesn't kind of ring true. Yeah, yeah, yeah. He's got this kind of...
Go on YouTube to see the...
Elliot's doing it as you speak. Yeah, I won't attempt it. But I think he's shown tiny glimpses of being a good footballer. And I think people have noticed that. And everyone seems to love a cultured centre-back.
Mm.
People jump on top of that. But for anything that he's done good, he undoes that with silly mistakes all over the place. Not for me at all.
Yeah.
Not for me.
I don't know. I haven't got as strong opinion as you, because I have games that stick in my memory that where he's performed very well, like at Liverpool in the Capital One Cup semi-final. Yeah. So I don't know if I can write him off. I don't know if I'd be happy to have him as a backup centre back.
Hmm.
I think I could accept that. I don't think you could.
I think we should get him sold to the Vale.
Get him rid.
Get him to the Vale. He'd struggle there.
Is Vale higher than the German fifth tier?
Probably, yeah. I anticipate it is. You know, let's see if Vale can put a sneaky bid in for Woolsharks. I don't think he's for us at all. Okay. Sorry, Wooly. Sorry, Wooly.
So next up, Hossaloo, the Hoss.
Yeah.
He started off his Deportivo career with an injury, which ruled him out for 10 La Liga games.
Yeah.
He then came back. He started 4 or 5 games. Mm-hmm. I think he started more than that, but he's only completed 90 minutes, 4 or 5.
Yeah.
He scored 3 goals in La Liga, 1 in the Copa del Rey. The 3 against La Liga are very interesting.
Yeah.
2 against Real Madrid, 1 against Barcelona.
Yeah. I mean, I think a lot of Stoke fans will agree that Hossaloo, is that the right accent for that?
I think so.
Hossaloo.
You've been practicing your Catalan today, Craig.
Yeah, for the timing. Should have been working, really. Anyway, I think a lot of Stoke fans agree that he was unfairly dropped from the team on several occasions, and myself included. Whenever he played well. I think he struck that perfect balance between cultured football and decent hold-up player.
Mm.
He's good of his head. I don't get it. I'm not quite sure why he's bombed out. And I always make the assumption that there was something wrong between personality-wise with the management team and himself, because he seemed to fit them all perfectly for that original formation of that man up top.
Mm.
Do you know what I mean? When we played 4-3-3, he was built for that Hossaloo type player.
Yeah.
I don't get it. I'm not sure. It cost a lot of money. What?
5.5? 6.5?
Enough money for a player that we just bombed out of the squad anyway.
Fucking the same level as Dave Kitson.
Yeah. He was great, though.
Yeah. But I don't know. He's a good finisher for me. I've seen some of the goals he's put away. The finish at Watford. Great, the finish against...
Norwich as well. At home. Good finish.
Like Bournemouth. Yeah. Not Bournemouth. He did score.
He scored against Bournemouth. Header one too.
Everton. I meant.
Yeah, in the great
3-2.
Finish.
That was a great finish on the bounce. I don't know if he just came in at the wrong time when Hughes still didn't know what he wanted to do.
Yeah,
but
a massive question mark.
We're playing two up front now.
Yeah, and
room for him next season.
I think so. I love Walters. I love Crouch, but I can't help but think that a player like Hossaloo combines the best qualities of both of them. Really, I get the impression he won't come back to Stoke properly.
You don't think he will?
I just don't think Hughes fancies him. I'm not sure why. I just don't think he does.
So that's another one ruled out.
Yeah.
You've gone no Walshide, no Hossaloo.
I'd like Hossaloo back, but I don't think he will.
I think I've got too much sentiment. I'd say I'll take them both back.
Would you?
But talking about sentiment, Bojan.
Oh dear. Yeah.
He's made 3 starts so far and played only 5 games. But to be fair, Mainz are in some absolutely terrible form. They won't. Yeah. They probably won't get dragged into relegation in the Bundesliga because they have the weird system. So two immediately get relegated.
Yeah.
And then
it's like a playoff thing.
Playoffs are awesome. I think we should have that.
It's mega.
So it's 18th plays the person who finishes 3rd in the Bundesliga. Yeah. They have a home and away.
Brilliant.
And
I think they should do that.
If you win, you go up. If you lose, you go down.
It's great, isn't it?
It's fucking ace. I think we should employ that system. Yeah. But
he's not pulling up trees, is he?
He's not doing anything of note.
Oh, I don't know what to say about Bojan anymore. I don't know. I'm not sure. I mean,
now this is one I definitely keep.
I would as well, 100%.
But I think he's gone.
Yeah, I agree with that sentiment. I'd love to have him back, but I think the relations with Hughes seem to have been damaged quite a lot.
And where does he fit into a 4-4-2 if we're sticking with
that? Oh, he doesn't at all, does he?
He doesn't.
Not I mean, he barely fit into a 4-3-3. 4-4-2.
He barely fitted in Hughes' squad with a number 10.
Yeah, exactly.
Never mind one without.
It's such a shame, isn't it? I think it'll go down in Stoke City folklore, Bojan, as the player that almost was.
He was a rock, whoever, Hudson or whatever.
He really was great, wasn't he?
I remember going absolutely nuts when we signed him.
One thing I will say, and I've said it about Bojan a few times, I think we look back on his purple patch a bit too rose-tinted. I'm not saying it wasn't great, but I think people exaggerate the length of this purple patch.
Yeah.
Because reality was, in his first season, he had a poor start, really poor start. He came back against, I think it was West Ham at home, played really well. Then I think, in total, you're looking at 2.5-3 months where he was very good. That's it. I know he's had his injury, but he's not done it since. I don't know. I'd love nothing more for the Bojan thing to work again, but I think it's
run its course.
The tale of Bojan is slowly concluding, and it's a shame because we almost had something there.
Yeah,
we almost had something. We almost had the next Stoke City legend.
I
think he still is. I think people will forever eulogise about how good he was, but
it's still hurting me.
I know, as you can tell.
Still hurting me.
I loved him.
And he's coming back.
You are gutted.
Yeah, I fucking loved him.
You're gutted.
Absolutely loved him. And, you know, I've still got hopes that he comes back and it works somehow.
Yeah, I mean, in a 4-4-2, the only remote position he could play is up front with Berahino. Would that work? Probably not. Berahino is the sort of short guy, feed off a big guy player. And Bojan isn't that.
I don't think it's. I don't think he's coming back.
You're right, mate.
But no, I'm not.
You look bloody heartbroken.
I've got some alcohol.
Yeah, that'll soothe the pain of Bojan departing, isn't it?
So yeah, so that's three. You've ruled out three. I've said I'll take.
I mean, yeah, I will take two, but I think all three have done.
Yeah, I think all three. Maybe.
Yeah, I think they're all done. I think they're all done.
And then speak of people who are done. Mm-hmm. Jacob Hogard.
Is it Wigan? I don't even know.
Is it Wigan? He had a great debut. Saved a penalty where Wigan won the game.
Yeah.
Then it all went a little bit wrong.
Right.
He's made errors, then got a shoulder injury. Uh-huh. Been out for 7 games, but then returned to the bench in their last game out.
Okay.
Wigan's last game.
Yeah, yeah.
What can you say?
I mean, we can't. I mean, obviously, Mark Hughes and the scouting network at Stoke have got more experience than me.
Mm.
In UL, unless you've done some scouting thing I'm not aware of. But I don't know how this one slipped through the net into our first team. I mean, how old is he? 21, 22, 23-ish?
So.
Something like that. Maybe it is confidence. I mean, he looks like a keeper. He really is a big lad, isn't he? I remember the first game I saw him, I forget who it was against at home, but I remember him coming to claim a cross, and he was great, he looked very confident. I thought, yeah, he could be up to something. But some of the goals he conceded were almost worse than mistakes. They just didn't seem to have the natural instinct of a keeper.
Mm.
Like ball, he just wasn't seeming to react to standard shots. And he's gonna
another one who's done.
Yeah, 100%. He'll just be resigned to the keeper books. Who was that Finnish keeper we had years ago? Yarni something or other. If you're listening, who was the Finnish keeper we had when we got promoted from League One? We bought him for like a quarter of a million at the time, which is a lot of money, and he never played.
You're older than me, I can't remember.
I can't remember his name now. Someone let us know, if you listen to the podcast, who was the Finnish keeper?
Do let us know on Twitter.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's our loan signings. I'm not going to go into all our loan signings.
No.
Your Moas, your Shentons, because that's just too much research that I can't be asked to do.
Not worth it.
First team I'll do.
Yeah, they don't want it.
Yeah, no one else wants the rest.
No.
Except the Academy pedos.
Yeah. I don't know if they're listening.
Don't know if they're listening.
If they are, let us know what's going on.
Right.
The job.
So we've got some not quick fire, but we'll rattle through these.
Mm-hmm.
Dan Stevenson, Rhiannon Gallimore, and Casey on Twitter said, "What would you like to see happen in the summer transfer window?"
Good question. Left back,
definitely.
As we've agreed, this is probably going to annoy people, but I wouldn't mind if Shaq went in the summer. I'm not saying I'd actively try and flog him, but if the right offer come in, it's fine with me.
China comes in, 25-30 million.
100%.
Okay.
I'd be tempted with 15.
Would you?
Yeah. I just think he don't play. He don't play. He's
getting your money back.
Yeah, he don't play. I mean, I'm not saying Shaq's rubbish. I'm not saying he's been a washout for Stoke. There's been moments, but I think we could spend that money better than we have done.
Before he does go, let's give him a go at number 10.
There isn't a number 10 anymore, though, is there?
Let's go back and give him a go at number 10.
Yeah. I'd
like to see that. That's where he plays best for his country.
Yeah, we've never really done that. I think he's wandered into the number 10 position by accident sometimes, and he's looked alright.
Doesn't like playing on the wing.
He doesn't, does he? And he's not a winger despite all the kind of hype that comes with that.
He's not fast.
He's not fast at all.
He's too fucking muscly to be fast.
He is, and he doesn't beat his men. He doesn't never gets on the outside.
Cuts in and crosses.
He drives at the wall. But yeah, Shaq to go. Other positions.
Bruno on a permanent.
I think we could do with another set. No, could we do with a centre back? We've got Cameron and Mooney, who are decent.
Got Walshire coming back.
yeah. In that case, let's look for another centre back. I don't know. It's a difficult centre mid. We've got millions of them, haven't we? It's weird because I look throughout the whole squad and I don't see glaring weaknesses. I see a reasonably solid consistency across. Mm. I don't really know what. Maybe.
Just like an upgrade.
Yeah, maybe an upgrade up front, because I think Walters and Crouch are obviously getting on a little bit, and I think we need maybe an upgrade on them.
Yeah.
It's a really difficult question, actually. There's no glaring position that looks horrendous at the moment. I'm struggling, Al.
It is difficult.
What do you reckon?
It is difficult. The wings look sorted. You know, you've got Sobby and Arnie. Maybe,
yeah.
If, like you say, if Shaq did go, you maybe get a
probably backup. Winger in that case, because if Shaq does go, always pushed into that number 10 position.
Yeah.
You'd like we are really thin like on the wing, aren't we, then?
Yeah.
I don't know. I'll leave that one to Mark Hughes.
I think striker. I think we could do. I know we've just brought Berahino, but.
That's a really difficult. Can we put them out there to comments and Twitch and stuff?
Yeah.
What position needs to strengthen? Because I'm really struggling a little bit.
Left back, definitely.
Yeah.
You could probably say right back with the amount of injuries that we get there. Phil Bardsley and Glenn Johnson are getting
arguably.
On.
Yeah, you could arguably.
Probably say right back as well.
It's frustrating though, because I think we've got two very capable right backs. In fact, it's a quick question I want to put back out there to people that are listening.
I'm going to have to deal with all these tweets, Craig.
It's fine. Don't worry about that. So we've obviously got Phil Bards and Glenn Johnson. I think generally Glenn Johnson has been considered our number one right back. But I think on Saturday, Bardsley at least levelled that claim. He was great on Saturday against Chelsea.
He's been an unsung player this season.
100%. And I think for me now, truly 100%, there is no definite right back out of Bardsley and Johnson that's automatically, when fit, going to play that position. I really think they're neck and neck for who should play there. Bardsley's been great when he's come in. Bardsley's done really well
since he's come in. You know, it shows what he can do when he's not beating up Wayne Rooney on weekends.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and I think he's a slightly better footballer than people give him credit for. Getting forward, he's
definitely.
He's head and shoulders better than Pieters.
Yeah, definitely.
But then I don't take too much. But yeah.
Right, next question. John Glanfield. Why do we score so few goals with the flair and attacking power we have? Because we're crap. Because we're not. We just don't play that way.
I don't know.
We just don't play with flair and attack at the minute. I don't think football's that exciting.
It's such a good question, and it's the million-dollar question. I'm sorry to answer with such a horrendous answer, but I truly do not have a clue. I've been racking my brain for that. On paper, we've got so much decent attacking intent, and I don't know why we're not. It's not just we're not scoring. We rarely
create.
I think Middlesbrough was one of the few games where we actually created several decent, very, very decent goal-scoring opportunities, but I can't remember the last game of the Middlesbrough where we generally battered a team.
Some excitement's been restored by Sobby.
Yeah, he's given us that a little bit, hasn't he?
He's given us a little bit more.
Yeah, I can only blame the formation of 4-3-3.
When you've got to factor in players like John Waters, like Mamadou sometimes, like Peter Crouch.
Yeah.
You are sacrificing your flair.
Yeah.
You're sacrificing what's going to be going on in that game. You're not going to have ball on the ground.
Yeah.
It is all going to be maybe up in the air or completely different.
Yeah.
So,
but we did do that. We have fielded teams with all the flair people out. Wolves at home, for example, and didn't work either.
It did happen. No, it didn't work.
So, I mean, we've really not answered that at all. We've not even remotely started to address that. But I really don't know. I can only vaguely suggest that 4-3-3, for whatever reason, doesn't suit these flair players. That's a crap answer. It's not even an answer at that. It's just awful. But that's all I can remotely come to conclusion of. Sorry.
Sorry, John.
We don't answer it.
We'll
put that one back out there, Ellen. You can field the answer for us.
We haven't got the definitive answer for that one. Andrew McCafferty sort of said, "Do you feel like there's some dressing room unrest?"
Not really.
I think I did a couple of points this season. I don't know if there is now. But, you know, when Bojan was complaining, in Mbula.
Shaq's had a bit of a sulk sometimes, hasn't he?
Said it publicly.
Bonnie.
Bonnie. It's come out last week.
He's had a bit of a rant, hasn't he, Bonnie?
A bit of a rant saying that Hughes told him everything's okay and training is doing well, then why doesn't he even get a sniff? So, yeah, I think there is a little bit.
A few things, but I imagine that most Premier League teams have that.
Let me be fair as well. Peter Crouch also had a moan. He gets away with it because it's Crouch.
Yeah, yeah, he does.
But he was moaning.
Yeah.
At points when he wasn't playing.
Fire earlier. Comedy, though.
Fire comedy, yeah.
So it's
you
fine.
You do it funny? It's absolutely fine.
I don't think so. I think what we've seen with Stoke the past couple of seasons is a real kind of sort of clash of styles. You had the old British guard sort of players. Then we had all these flair players coming. And I don't know. I get the impression there was maybe a slight segregation of groups. Whenever the guys go away to train or a summer break or whatever they do, there always seems to be the pitch on Instagram. There's two separate parties, isn't there?
There's that two separate.
Yeah. I call it, one is the Glenn Whelan party, one's the Arnautovic party. And they seem to be a little bit separate. I'm sure all clubs have it. They're not all going to be best mates, but.
Yeah, little clicks.
Maybe that just happens. It happens in life, doesn't it? I don't think there's too much to worry about in terms of unrest. Myself.
It'll all be sorted in the summer anyway. We're shipping half of them off.
Yeah, they can all go, can't they?
Yeah. Nathan Stokey Dre asks an interesting question. Where will we be in 5 to 10 years' time?
Massive ninth.
That's what I was going to say.
Yeah, that's all you
got. Rooted into ninth in the Brent Barclays. That's where we'll be.
Where we'll be
in We'll have a fucking new corner.
We'll have a new corner, yeah.
Scoreboards.
Which I'm eagerly following the progress of that. I reckon.
Not as eager as a certain Stoke fan page. Pictures daily.
Oh, mate, I love it. I'm all for it. I'm so excited. I know I'm getting off this question, but I'm so excited about it. It's like your house getting an extension. It's like we're knocking up a conservatory on the back. I like to think that in 5 years' time, we'll be still up a mid table. We may have nicked the odd 8th or even 7th place finish, and
could you see us on a cup run?
And we've hopefully nicked the League Cup and in dream world the FA Cup. That's what I want.
You're asking a lot there, Craig. I'd take a final.
Would you?
Yeah,
I want to win it. We need
to take a semi-final if it was a trip to Wembley FA Cup. I'd take a day out.
Don't get me wrong, I would, but I want this little area to be crowned with a trophy. I love the 72 story.
In 5 to 10 years' time.
72 story.
In 5 to 10 years' time, is Mark Hughes still here?
No chance. No. Well, 10 years, definitely not. I think. Those are a bit hasty with that answer. I mean, if he consistently is mid table, why wouldn't he be, I suppose?
What players are still here in 5 years' time?
Whelan will be propping up in midfield, won't he? Still. John Walters, Crouch up front. Butland. Apparently, I saw a link to Arsenal Liverpool in the Daily Mirror today.
Yeah,
Butland.
He's already rubbished it.
Good, because he needs to come back first before he gets going. We'll have Crouch and Walters up front, Whelan in the middle, Shawcross at the back in 10 years' time.
Shawcross,
they'll all be done by then, won't they?
Sam B, I don't know why I didn't get his full name. Sam B, could be a number of people.
Mm-hmm.
Is Berahino the striker to solve our problems?
For want of different options out there, yeah, he's going to be. I think he's got the credentials to do it. Definitely. He is realistically the best striker we could have got, bar some random wonder kid that we've done some good scouting on. So 100%
from abroad.
Yeah, exactly.
That's all our questions.
Good questions, then.
Good questions. Quick fire round.
I feel like some of them we answered quite poorly. We didn't really give a decent response.
Sorry,
so apologies for that.
Absolutely awful answers.
Yeah,
but we will wrap it up there. And I know you've also got to go and record. Great touch for a
great
big
touch
lad.
For a big lad.
How many times have we plugged?
Every episode.
Your other podcast.
So if you like
cheating on me.
No, mate, no, it's got to be done. If you like a football podcast, listen to Great Touch for a Big Lad. It's a very good listen, if I do say so myself.
It is.
We need to get you on, actually. I should come on to it.
I will. Yeah. I will one time.
If you want to hear a Stoke, you mix it with a Chelsea, Brentford and QPR fan.
There you go.
If you don't,
and James
it's not for you.
From Ball Street.
And James Alcott from Ball Street.
If you follow Ball Street.
Yeah.
Anyway. If you want to win this Saido Berahino signed shirt, which is going to eventually by the end of the season have more signatures on, do like this wherever you're watching it, listening to it. Leave a comment wherever you're liking, listening, watching.
Yeah.
And also leave us a review on iTunes because we like the reviews.
We should read them out. We should read the reviews
We'll read all reviews.
Or more specifically, five-star reviews.
Maybe not this time next week. The reason I say not this time next week is because this time next week... It's the big one, Craig.
Oh, it is, yeah. You know what? I didn't know you were on about them, but yeah, the penny drop.
We won't leave us reviews on iTunes, but we won't be reading them out next week because next week is the big one. Yeah. We're barring any cancellations.
Which has happened.
That are Clive Clark-esque.
Yeah.
We will be interviewing Rory Delap.
Taking a little trip to Derby, aren't we?
A little trip to Derby, yeah. To the Delap household, and we're going to be speaking to Rory Delap. That will be the next Bear Pit Pod. I'm excited.
I'm really excited. And what I'm excited about, Rory seems like a decent bloke. Looking forward to chatting to him. He really seems like a top guy. Obviously a Stoke City legend. Yeah, buzzing about that.
I said in, was it our first one when we did the getting to know each other, my favourite Stoke player ever.
Yeah, you did, didn't you?
Yeah. I'm well excited. I think I'm going to be starstruck.
Oh yeah.
So if you can calm me down,
I'll step in and save you.
Yeah, yeah. Like take the reins if I'm a bit nervous. So yeah, people watching, listening, that is coming up next week. Cannot wait for that. Do go and give this a like and whatever, and review wherever you're watching us. Thank you for listening, and we'll see you all next week.
See you later. Bye bye.